Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of the Lakers Nation podcast. I am Trevor Lane. You can find me on Twitter at Trevor underscore Lane. We are powered by LakersNation.com and CLNS Media. Lakers basketball is back. The preseason is starting up. I can't believe it. My head is spinning. It feels like just yesterday the Lakers were winning the NBA championship, and here we are playing again, and I can't wait. Joining me today, one of my favorite people to talk Lakers basketball with, Alan Sliwa. Alan, how are you doing, man?
What's going on, Trev? You ready? I'm ready, man.
I am so ready. I was perfect timing. I just got my City Edition t-shirt, which I had to wear for this show with you. I just got it yesterday, just showed up, went perfect timing. I'm ready for the new season to start up. And I'll tell you what, we got the news today that LeBron and Anthony Davis are not going to play in Friday's first game against the Clippers. I want to say I don't care, but that's not really the right words to use. It hasn't dulled my excitement at all for Friday's game. That, I mean, I want to see LeBron and AD, but I'm so fired up to see Lakers basketball. I am just as excited as when I thought they might actually play in that game.
What I put out a tweet to just kind of saying that, and it took me a second to like process it, because a couple days ago, Coach said they most likely will not play, and I had a lot of comments. I'm reading the comments, and they're saying, "Yeah, that's fine." You know, so I think a lot of Laker fans too are okay with it. It's this is going to be such a unique year. December 11th, which is tomorrow, will be 60 days since the Lakers won that championship against the Miami Heat. So I think you got a lot of Laker fans that are, you know, sometimes you want to watch the stars play every single game. But I think in this circumstance for the Lakers, being cautious and kind of thinking big picture, nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I mean, you want to rest these guys. You want to make sure, especially the first preseason game, no one is going to remember how the Lakers played in the very first preseason game of the year, right? What matters is
LeBron,
the longevity.
40 minutes. 40
yes. Minutes for LeBron. Play. Don't even sub him. 48 minutes for LeBron. Get out there. Win at all costs. This, you know, it's preseason. It's just to kind of go through the motions. I would be surprised. I haven't seen anything official. I would be surprised if Paul George or Kawhi Leonard were playing in that one as well. But that's not really what this game is about. But by the way, before we even get into this Lakers versus Clippers game, we should talk about the big game that our fans have been talking about on social media. Somehow this is becoming a thing, Alan. This concept that you
need to play
a one-on-one basketball game. They are pitting us against each other, and they want to see us play. At some point, we're going to have to figure out a way to make this happen.
So I don't know where you are in your athletic, at this stage of your life, where you are athletically.
Declining quickly.
But I don't think I'm helping any viewers if we put that thing together. Like, I don't, let's just say, I don't think this will be a content-driven one-on-one matchup. So, I think both of people who like listening to our stuff, they really got to rethink this concept.
they would definitely walk away disappointed, regardless of how low they set the bar, their expectations. They would be disappointed by the performance.
Are you
that,
a shooter?
That we put
Can
in.
You shoot? Can
well,
you
see, shoot? I'm a little bit. I don't want to give you all my secrets here, but I'm a lefty. Okay. I'm a lefty at playing when I'm playing basketball.
Southpaw action.
Yeah, okay. So that sometimes throws people off. I would say I'm a shooter, but I will admit I haven't shot a basketball in months since COVID's been going on. I haven't been getting into the gym or anything like that. So I have not shot a basketball in a long, long time. So it would be really ugly.
Trev, when we're done with this show, I'm doing wind sprints up and down the street preparing. Okay, I'm getting ready for this thing now.
All right, we're going to put together some Rocky style training montages, and we're going to promote this thing. And we're going to figure out some way. We'll
I like it.
We'll share it. We'll share it on our respective YouTube channels at some point. We'll figure out some way to get it done. Alan, let's talk about the guys that we actually want to see play, though. Lakers, Clippers, preseason, no LeBron, no AD. I'd be surprised if the Clippers stars play, but I'm still excited to see so many of these Lakers players. And I've got a few of my guys that I'm really interested in seeing, but who is it with LeBron and AD on the sidelines that jumps out to you? It's like, man, I can't wait to see this guy in purple and gold.
Well, listen, you know, I don't think this is a surprise. And I think a lot of Laker fans, you know, will agree on this. Montrezl Harrell and Dennis Schroeder, those two additions to the Lakers, it's not like you're bringing in those two players and you're asking them, hey, they're just going to be role players. I think they're going to be bigger than role players, Trev. And I know that's funny to say because you got Anthony Davis and you got LeBron James there. But I don't know how the structure of this season is going to go. I know that LeBron is 36 years old come December 30th. He'll be 17 years in the league. I know that you know, obviously Anthony Davis is coming off a quick turnaround as well. What an opportunity for Dennis Schroeder and Montrezl Harrell. So when you say who are you most excited to see, it's not just for tomorrow, but this upcoming season, I think there's going to be a lot that goes on those two shoulders, of those two players. And I say that, you know, optimistically, because I think they could carry the load. Those are the two players that I just can't wait to see night in and night out for the Lakers.
Those are two additions that when I step back and I look at the offseason, I look at what teams around the NBA did, I go, wait a minute. The Lakers, the team that just won an NBA championship, they're not supposed to be able to get guys like that.
No.
Right? This mm-hmm. the reigning sixth man of the year and the runner-up to the sixth man of the year, who are 26 and 27 years old. A Lakers team with no cap space is not supposed to be able to go and get guys of this caliber. So I agree. I think those guys are very, very interesting. I'll tell you another name that I can't wait to see just based on this buzz that I've been hearing. Now we're hearing from multiple different people that have been saying, you know, hey, this guy might really have something here. This guy's going to carve out minutes. I'm talking about Talen Horton Tucker. I don't want to get my expectations too high, but so many people have been raving about him and the skill set is so interesting. I can't wait to see what Talen Horton Tucker looks like.
Well, we saw him too. I mean, how about in a playoff game when Coach Frank Vogel put him in against the Rockets and he didn't look like one of those players. You know, there's certain players that if you put them in a game, the moment will kind of take over. It's too tough of a moment, or they can tell that, all right, this is my chance. This is my opportunity. I don't want to screw it up. And Talen Horton Tucker in a playoff game where everybody's got their eyes on the Los Angeles Lakers, how comfortable did he look? How smooth, calm, cool, and collective did he seem? So you got a reason to be excited for a 20-year-old that's coming into the NBA that is got some experience now under his belt and probably got some confidence as well.
Yeah, I mean, you have to get confidence when you're out there playing against James Harden and then you're finding success. When you take him off the dribble and finish with this nice little finger roll at the rim, you've got to like that. He's able to pull those things off. You know, LeBron James is in his corner. By the way, Alan, you said when you've got this chance, you've got this opportunity. I thought you were going to go a little Eminem on me there. I thought you were going to throw in, you know, you got one chance to seize this opportunity, something like that, you know.
I was ready to go into a whole rap.
I thought that's where you were heading with it. But let's talk a little bit though about Marc Gasol, because this is something that I thought about. I was thinking about this morning. I'm out walking my dog and I'm thinking, you know, we've been talking about Montrezl Harrell. We've been talking about Dennis Schroeder and rightfully so. Are we overlooking Marc Gasol and the impact he can make? I think about the Lakers offense. Now you're talking about a starting five, assuming Gasol is in that starting five. Every single player can shoot the three. They didn't have that last season. I'm so curious to see what that's going to look like, because that was the plan last season heading in, was Boogie Cousins, who can shoot the three, as your big, and then that got derailed and they turned to Dwight Howard and JaVale McGee. So I'm curious to see what Frank Vogel does. Does that open up the offensive playbook a little bit to have a guy that can shoot the three without sacrificing size? So that's why I'm kind of excited to see what Marc Gasol can bring. Even though I know he's not the guy he was 5-6 years ago, I think he can still make a big difference for this squad.
So there are certain, I remember the night, or was it the morning? Did we get Marc Gasol in the morning or the night? I can't remember. We had all those signings going on.
It's a blur. It's a blur at this point for me.
but Laker fans, you know, obviously coming off the history of Pau Gasol, but just the skill set that those two brothers have. And Marc Gasol is easy player to respect and appreciate what he's done in the league for a number of years. And he's got an NBA championship. I think we are overlooking him. I'm overlooking him. Not to say that I thought he was a very, very key addition, especially because, look, you lost Dwight, you lost JaVale McGee, you lost some major size. And by the way, that's going to be, you know, I think as the season progresses, I'm curious to see how Marc Gasol, Markieff Morris, and Montrezl Harrell kind of keep that size, I guess you could say, as best as they can, even though two of those players are undersized. They bring different skill sets from last year's big men.
Right.
But Marc Gasol has the ability to he's got the ability to do things that not many big men can do. Like you said, he could step out and hit an 18-footer consistently or a 22-footer. He's one of the better big men from a passing perspective. So what does Marc Gasol become when you're playing with AD? What does Marc Gasol become when you got LeBron James on your team? So you got a lot of different storylines. I got a chance on Monday I had Wesley Matthews on Lakers Talk. Mm-hmm. And here's another new addition to the Lakers, right? Trev, it's great listening to the guy. He's hungry. He's been in the league for 12 years. He hasn't won an NBA championship. He's undrafted. He's excited to play with a lot of these players. So there are a number of guys that either they're coming back to try and get championships, or they're on this roster and they're hungry to try and, you know, get their first one. And we'll get that opportunity, you know, come tomorrow. We know what LeBron and AD are going to bring every night. So they don't play tomorrow. We get to start seeing some of these other guys.
Are you concerned at the fact that Marc Gasol is really the only true center on the floor? I mean, you've got Harrell, who's a 4-5. You've got Anthony Davis, who also plays the 4 and certainly can play the 5 as well. But last season, they had JaVale McGee and Dwight Howard, these true back-to-the-basket style centers, even though you're not going to post them up a lot, rim protectors, rebounders. You don't really have that skill set this season. Is that a worry for you? Because my sense from the Lakers fan base has been that is their number one concern right now.
I'm with them. I'm with them in the sense that it was just such a luxury last year. I mean, Dwight was coming off the bench last
right.
year. I mean, just think about that for a second, right? So Dwight was coming off the bench. He was giving you some nights you needed 20 minutes from him. Sometimes some nights you needed 10 minutes from him, but he was there, you know? So you had this luxury where at some stage you can go all small. Other times you can go, you know, obviously big. You had these options, I think, last season where you got all the same options this upcoming year, except for that one extra big. So we'll see what happens. I think the good thing is this. The good thing is the way the Lakers played out last season, you know, they addressed areas that they felt they needed come the buyout market. And you'll be able to do that also at the trade deadline. So if you're walking into this season with the roster that you have, every roster is going to have a hole or two, and Lakers probably have the least amount of holes in the entire NBA. But it's not like the roster that you have today has to be the roster that you walk into the playoffs with. So if there's one area, I would say, yeah, that's the area that I'd be, you know, most concerned with. But at the same time, I think I got enough confidence in the front office that they can still figure out a way to make that happen and to address it.
Yeah, agreed. I think it's my top concern right now as well. Just I would like to see them have that skill set. And I've talked about this a lot. I want to see them have as many different skill sets as they can, because Frank Vogel has proven that he's a guy that can mix and match successfully. He can find advantages and exploit those advantages. I mean, look at how many different starting lineups they had just in the playoffs, right? Whether it was Markieff Morris coming in, JaVale, Dwight Howard, even Alex Caruso. They had a lot of different guys that they rotated in there in order to try to take advantage of the situation. And sometimes you're going to want that extra big body there where I feel like they could use another person. But again, they only have 14 players under contract right now, not 15. They'll eventually, somewhere down the line, the veteran minimum salary will prorate enough to where they can add in a 15th player. There's going to be some opportunities for them to add some other people. Speaking of which, Pau Gasol. This came out yesterday. Zach Lowe from ESPN did an interview with Pau Gasol, and he said he wants to come back and he wants to play for the Lakers. Right now, he's 40 years old. He's in training. We're talking right now about the Lakers potentially needing another big. Where do you stand on that idea? 40-year-old Pau Gasol, is he a guy that you would look to come in and maybe help alleviate that issue?
Well, it's funny because Marc Gasol was asked that question earlier mm-hmm. today
yeah.
when they do their Zoom calls. And Mark had mentioned, he's like, look, he's got to just worry about his health, about his rehabbing. He's got to see if his body can do it again, you know, and that's still a question mark. That's not a guarantee or a lock that Pau, even if he did decide, I'm good, I'm ready, if it's something that's sustainable for him. So typically, this is what I would say. I'm not a fan of just bringing a player on the roster. Let's use under these circumstances because of where the Lakers are. You got a chance to win an NBA championship. You're trying to go back to back. You and I just talked about how there's a need at that position. So mm-hmm. if Pau did come hypothetically and it took away from a player that can help you down the road to trying to, you know, grab championship number 18, I feel like moves like that happen with teams that are not fighting for a championship, right? Like Vince Carter to Atlanta. Certain players that can do certain things because they're not competing for a championship. Lakers are. But Trev, with all that said, I love Pau.
We all do.
Pau's one of my favorite Lakers. And what would you really be asking him to do if he's healthy? Okay. If Like, I don't think the Lakers would bring him as a, hey, let's do this because Powell's history with the Lakers.
No.
I think they would bring him because they feel like at his age and for what the Lakers would need from him, plus, by the way, he'd probably be the best locker room guy that you could have.
Yes.
And his knowledge of the game and being able to help guys like Montrezl Harrell or Mark. How about him just being with Anthony Davis on the same roster and just helping him with maybe using his left hand a little bit more? Like, you know, little things like that. Mm-hmm. So I say all that as much as I think I was leaning towards, no, this isn't one of those things. If the Lakers brought him back, I have confidence that the front office would bring him back because they felt like they can still use him. And if that's a position that the Lakers are deficient in, I would rely on the front office. If they thought he's good to go, how great would it be to have Powell with LeBron and AD and some of these other players?
I mean, that's kind of where we were with Dwight Howard, right? Dwight had to go and audition for the Lakers and prove that he was healthy because he was having, I believe it was back issues the season before. Yeah. And he showed up and turns out he was in great shape. He's absolutely shredded and he killed it all season long. Powell obviously has been dealing with foot injuries, but he's posted some footage of himself working out and trying to get ready to go. Again, 40 years old. That's tough. That's really tough to play at 40, but he's putting out that info that he would like to come back and play and he wants to contribute. So I would say if he's going to come back, you're talking about a guy who maybe plays 10 minutes a night tops. And even then it's just to fill that specific role. Again, if he proves that he's healthy for all the reasons that you mentioned, I'm at least open to the idea, but there's certainly going to be a little bit of reservation there. And in particular, because maybe another guy that we're not talking about enough is Devontae Kaycock. You know, this guy finished up last season, first team all G League, and he was just a monster on the boards. No, he's also not a rim protector. But is that a guy, you know, now that we're seeing because of COVID, the NBA has relaxed some of the rules on G League players. So now they can play up to 50 games with the team. So this is a guy that maybe you can turn to in the middle a little bit, even if he is still bouncing back and forth between the G League, if the G League squad is going. We don't even know what that's going to look like just yet. But this is a guy they might be able to utilize a lot more than they were last season. And that's where I start thinking, do I want to give those minutes to a 40-year-old Powell, or do I want to still develop this young guy and see what he can do, see what he can be? I think that's an option as well. Not saying anything against Powell, because like you said, I love him, but I think there's another option in-house that maybe we're not considering enough.
Yeah, Trev, you just said it. You don't love Pau Gasol. I mean, I don't know what more you want me to tell you. I mean, I'm shocked here. You know, but Trev, think about this for a second. We are talking about the hole for the Lakers is a backup center who would play about 10 minutes a game. Like that also just kind of shows just how stacked the team is, right? Like how there's going to be many games Anthony Davis might play the five for the Lakers, right? It's going to be stretches in a game where AD's the five and Montrezl Harrell is the four. I'm just using as an example. There's going to be some times where Markieff Morris says, you know what, let me take their big man. He's not going to be a huge threat. Let me just kind of body him around and make sure. That's the one thing I give Montrezl Harrell and I give Markieff Morris. By the way, didn't Markieff Morris come to the Lakers to kind of match up against a guy like Montrezl Harrell with the Clippers? That was kind of the game plan last season, was if you face them in the Western Conference Finals. But with that being said, Montrezl Harrell and Markieff Morris are undersized big men, but this is what will not happen with those two players. They're not going to get pushed around. They're not going to get out hustled. They're not going to be, you know, there's right. certain things. You can have bigs that are 7 foot, but play small, and you could have smalls who are 6'8", 6'9", that play big. And I think both of those guys play big. So can you imagine other fan bases right now saying, is this really what the Lakers are complaining about? The backup center that's going to play 10 minutes? But that's the truth. That's where our lineup is right now.
That's right. That's where it's at this moment. That's a credit to how good of a job they've done building out this roster. I mean, if you look, in theory, I mean, I'm not going to say Schroeder's starting. I'm not going to say he's coming off the bench. But let's assume he's playing some minutes with the bench unit, right? Your bench unit for the Lakers would potentially be a pretty good starting team if you've got, say it's Schroeder and Wes Matthews, Kyle Kuzma, maybe it's a Markieff Morris.
Alex Caruso.
Alex Caruso. You can go with a three-guard lineup, so you can put Alex Caruso in there, and you're looking at Montrezl Harrell. Like, that's your bench unit. That could be a pretty good starting squad for a lot of teams. So I think the Lakers have some real depth here this season, and I mean, what a great time to have that luxury too, because with everything going on with COVID and all this kind of stuff, I think the depth is going to be a really important piece to this season.
Well, and you know, that's going to be the part where none of us can prepare for, right?
Yeah.
Like you and I can sit here and have conversations and say that, look at our lineup compared to this team and how many minutes should this guy play? There's an element of this season that none of us can control. None of us, you know, obviously truly understand. And that's the one thing that I thought COVID was going to have more of an impact in the bubble. What I'm referring to there, didn't you just assume that once you got into the Orlando bubble, that a player would test positive in the playoffs? And that player was going to be out for 10 to 14 days. And that could have decided the series of whatever round that was or whatever the case is. And it never happened. So, you know, I'll try to be optimistic this upcoming year, but the reality is that could play a part. And if it does, then the hope is that at least you're positioned by the time the playoffs start, that everybody's healthy, everybody's good to go. Maybe that vaccine is widespread now and we're able to kind of get back to a somewhat of a normal structured life.
Yeah, I mean, knock on wood, hopefully they're able to get through it and have success. But I think that is one thing that's clear is we are going to see positive, and we've already seen some, right? In both test rounds, we've seen positive cases come back. So that's going to be just a factor this season, unfortunately. But it's the way it goes. It's the world that we live in. So the Lakers take on the Clippers in game one. Actually, both games, game one and game two of their 4-game preseason schedule are against the Clippers because it's preseason. Do you think that's going to diminish sort of the, when I use the word rivalry, Lakers fans get mad at me because they say it's not a rivalry. The Clippers have never won, all that. I get it. I agree. But whatever this is, this animosity between the two teams, do you think it's diminished because LeBron and Anthony Davis aren't playing and maybe the Clippers guys are or aren't playing? We're not sure yet. Or do you think these two teams are still going to be kind of getting after each other? What do you expect to see there?
So I think there's storylines, and you are right. I get the same thing. Like if you do use the word rivalry, all hell breaks loose. But what I know exactly what you're saying. There is a first of all, I think these are the two best teams in the NBA. I think these are the two teams that are going to face each other in the Western Conference Finals. We'll see if the Clippers come through this time. I think there's plenty of storylines between the two franchises. Add now Montrezl Harrell coming to the Lakers and thinking that the Clippers didn't want him to play. For these first two games, do I think some of that stuff is there and lingering? Probably not. I think, you know, I look, if you're the Clippers, you were pretty much last season. Everybody was talking about how you're going to win the championship and you're going to beat the Lakers, and you didn't come through. So you really don't have anything to say. And if you're the Lakers, like LeBron James, you're smart enough to know that all we're doing right now is preparing for January and then preparing for February and preparing for March. There's this long marathon that you have in front of you. So you and I and other Laker fans will enjoy certain matchups. We'll enjoy seeing players we've never seen wear a Lakers jersey before represent the Lakers. Like I think we're going to enjoy that part of it. But I think there's going to be big storylines. Was it a preseason game when it was Doug Christie and Rick Fox? Was that
Oh
a preseason
gosh.
game when they
I remember it
Was that a
happening. I
preseason
don't
game when
recall
they
if it was
fought?
preseason or not. It
Well,
might
I
have
don't think
been.
that's going to happen. Let's
No.
just say I don't think that's going to be happening happening tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't anticipate seeing that happen either. I think it's going to be a little bit diminished in terms of how heated the two teams are. You know, during the regular season, it's going to be a bit of a different story, but preseason, everybody's going to be just kind of trying to figure out what they're doing, their sets. I mean, Frank Vogel has talked about how they haven't really ran a normal training camp because they've been very aware of the amount of rest guys need, the lack of rest that they got during the offseason. And so they haven't really gone through a very serious training camp here in terms of getting their bodies prepared. So I imagine that we're going to see some sloppy play. We're going to see the guys that are they're looking a little bit rusty, and I don't think we're going to see them going 100 miles an hour. At least I hope not. I hope not. I don't want to see
No, I
anybody get
don't.
hurt in a preseason game. Just kind of
No, and
learn.
I don't think they will, Trev. I'm with you. I definitely don't think they will. I think all this is just going to be prep.
Yeah, then it has to be. It has to be. Just run your sets, do what you need to do. For the Lakers, it's figuring out things with it, with an extra floor spacer on the floor and Marcus Gasol, figuring out your defense. Because that's another thing, Alan. The Lakers' defense, too. No Dwight Howard, no JaVale McGee. That means the way they play on the defensive end is going to have to change a little bit. I don't know if you can funnel drives to the rim the way they did before if say AD is out and it's Montrezl Harrell in there. I don't think you can do that at this point. So I think that's going to be an interesting thing too, is to watch how Frank Vogel, who's a defensive mind, tweaks things. And I know that's not talking about the rivalry, but just something that popped in here that I'm curious about is how that shifts, in addition to how the offense shifts for this team this season, because the pieces are just so different compared to what we saw.
That's going to be, you know, every time you come into a new season, you know, there's sometimes where the roster is virtually the same, and it's common that it's virtually the same when you win an NBA championship. It's not common. Actually, I think where the Lakers are right now, you typically don't see this much turnover. So I think that's also another reason why there's so much intrigue to this upcoming year, because, you know, compared to last year, there's no Avery Bradley and there is no Rajon Rondo and Dwight Howard and JaVale McGee and Danny Green. That's a lot of pieces that the Lakers had. But I think that the younger the Lakers got, I think they'll be more up-tempo. I think we'll be a faster style. Maybe that makes up from some of those differences that they can't have on the defensive side.
And they were already just devastating in the fast break. That was, you know, number one on every team's whiteboard when they were playing the Lakers was stop the fast break, get back on defense. Yeah. Don't let them get out in transition. And now I think I agree with you. They're going to be even more devastating in transition. And I can't wait to see it. I mean, this is the franchise that was really built around Showtime in the 80s. That's what elevated them to the next level, took the sport to the next level, that rivalry between the Celtics and Lakers in the 80s. And that fast break was always synonymous with Lakers basketball. And I feel like we're getting back to that. I feel like this season, last season, they ran it really well. Don't get me wrong. But this season, I look at the pieces that they've got, and I'm thinking, man, they are going to be flying out there.
I want everybody to run but LeBron. I want LeBron to take his time. I want him to pace himself. Get ready for the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Isn't that funny, Trev? Like we talk about the up and down style that the Lakers probably can have, but you know, we're really referring to, I was mentioning this on one of my shows, and I threw out all these names. I said, what is Anthony Davis, Alex Caruso, Kyle Kuzma, Dennis Schroeder, Montrezl Harrell, Talen Horton-Tucker? What do all these guys have in common? I think a KCP, all of them are 27 and under. So, you know, it is drastic difference of how some of those players were playing last year. I think that it will definitely be up-tempo.
Yeah. Yep, I agree. I think it will be. And like you said, you know, LeBron, he can just play quarterback, right? Just hang out there, right? I mean, look, Phillip Rivers,
absolutely,
he doesn't move much, right? He just drops back in the pocket and kind of stands there and chucks the ball. Ben Roethlisberger, he's not a guy who's going to run a lot or scramble. I think LeBron can kind of play that role. Go ahead and start throwing those hit-ahead passes, and LeBron can rack up the assist that way. I'd be good with that.
Well, and LeBron, that's kind of the beauty of where he is in his career, because he's kind of been able to do it all. And whether above the rim, by the way, last season there were many times he was above the rim, or he's playing bully ball, or now he's adding more of a jump shot to his game on a consistent basis. But his, in my opinion, one of his best abilities in everything that he does for the game, he enjoys passing. I mean, he is, in my opinion, naturally a passer first than a scorer first, right? And I always say this when people try to compare LeBron and Jordan. I'm like, you're comparing the wrong players.
Yep.
LeBron and Magic is a much better comp, simply because those are two guys that appreciated the art of passing the ball. So as LeBron gets up there in age, 36 on December 30th, 17 years in the NBA, is going into his 18th season. Three seasons, the equivalent of three seasons, if you count three additional seasons, if you count all his playoff games that he's had. At this stage of his career, I think he's going to be as lethal and as deadly from passing the ball as he will be from a scoring perspective.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty astute observation, especially, I mean, leading the league in assists last season. I don't know if he does it this season, because he's got Dennis Schroeder to share that kind of responsibility with, but he is an elite passer. I feel like LeBron kind of patterned his game more off of, say, a Magic Johnson, whereas like Kobe patterned his game off Michael Jordan. I feel like that's kind of, those influences came in. LeBron, to me, the best comparison I've seen for LeBron has been, he's Magic Johnson with Karl Malone's body. And that's,
but so ridiculous.
Right?
It's true. Right. But like, just think about it. It's true. It's as if Karl Malone was bringing the ball up the court, you know, It was Stockton setting the screen for him. Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of funny that I've heard that before too. But that's his frame. What is he? 265, something along those lines. 6'8", 6'9". It's ridiculous.
And Alan, you've been in the locker rooms, and I've been in the locker rooms with LeBron, Dwight Howard. These are guys where you go into the locker room and you just go, "Geez, this guy. I mean, doesn't even look like a normal person, right? Like this is." He doesn't look human. Like he's a cyborg. You look at this guy and he's just muscle on top of muscle on top of muscle. It's incredible the way that these guys have stayed in shape. And again, credit to LeBron, credit to all these players for their ability to continue doing this year after year after year. And I can't wait to see what he's got in store for us this season, but let's finish on this. So Alan, if we had to chop it all down into one move,
yep.
Your favorite mm-hmm. Lakers move of the offseason, and they made a lot of them. There were a lot of mm-hmm. transactions made by the Lakers this offseason, but bring it all down. What was your one favorite thing that the Lakers did?
The Dennis Schroeder trade. The Schroeder deal was the fact that you replaced contracts. Danny Green's contract, the $15 million, replaced for Dennis Schroeder, and that's a position. You know, it's one thing sometimes to move money, and we know what happened after they got Wesley Matthews as well to kind of replace Danny Green's position, but put all that to the side. It's one thing to make a deal because you think that, okay, from a contract perspective, this is going to be more advantageous to us. It's another thing to add a 27-year-old point guard that can have significant impact in the game at a time where a Lakers roster, you need that. You know, it's Trev there. I think who was it? Everybody was making fun of the Detroit Pistons during free agency because they signed
Mason Plumlee.
Three big men or whatever.
Yeah.
They signed all these big men, right? And you already it's the Lakers were very strategic with every move. I do think the Schroeder deal was the most significant. I think it will have the most impact. And that's no disrespect to any other moves the Lakers made. But for me, that Schroeder deal can be a significant game changer.
It was a very shrewd move in order to get a young talent like that.
That's true.
But gosh, I'm bad. So Schroeder, look, the Lakers needed that. They were searching for that skill set for so long. That was why they brought in Dion mm-hmm. Waiters. They didn't have that other guy aside from LeBron who could get into the paint, collapse a defense, you know, kick out or finish at the rim or do any of those things. They didn't have that guy. And this is a guy they've wanted for a while now. That's what we've heard. They've tried to trade for him before and weren't able to get it done. So getting him now, I think that is a big, big move. Personally, I'm going to go back. Maybe it's the obvious one. It's low-hanging fruit, but I'm going to go the Anthony Davis signing because I was still surprised that he went for the 5-year deal, committing his prime to the Los Angeles Lakers. I loved that. I loved when that news broke. I know it was right on the heels of the LeBron extension, which was out of the blue. We were not expecting that at all. But the Anthony Davis thing, we knew it was coming, but we didn't know how many years it was going to be. And to see that commitment from Anthony Davis moving forward, that's a good moment. That's a big moment for the franchise, knowing that now you have that certainty that we will be building around LeBron James and Anthony Davis, two of what, the top five, top three players in the NBA, according to ESPN, top two. ESPN had them ranked today as number one and number two, LeBron and Anthony Davis. You're building around those two guys for at least the next 3 years. And I think that is a great, great place for the franchise to be.
Yeah, as a few people have said it, AD is your present and he's your future. Mm-hmm. And he really is. Look, walking into age 27, I would love nothing more than for us to be, as the season progresses, we're looking at each other and saying, man, AD's the best player in the NBA right now. And Anthony Davis has a legitimate shot at MVP this year. And at some point you want to see that torch being passed from LeBron to Anthony Davis. If there's ever a year, this was a short off season. LeBron, I thought, you know, there's a reason why he was finals MVP. It would be great to start seeing that as he goes into his 5-year contract with the Lakers, that he really starts becoming the best player in the world. And some could even make that argument because of what he already does on the defensive side, but you know what I'm referring to, part of his evolution as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And he's got the talent. He's got the talent to be, he could be the MVP this season, right? That is not out of the question for Anthony Davis. He certainly has that ability. And so I'm excited. I'm excited to see him get out there this season as well. Although he's not going to be playing tomorrow. Good with that. Rest these guys up. Let's get ready for the regular season, but that doesn't mean that I'm any less excited to see preseason kickoff, because I want to see what all these guys have been working on. I want to see THT, Talen Horton-Tucker, Kyle Kuzma. I want to see him out there. I want to see all the new additions, Montrezl Harrell, Dennis Schroeder, Marc Gasol. I can't wait. Here we go. Alan, man, thanks so much for doing this, giving us this this preseason breakdown. This has been a lot of fun. Always a pleasure getting to chat with you.
No, of course, Trev. And whenever you're ready to go one-on-one, you just let me know.
All right. We're going to have to set that thing up. Maybe once we can actually like gather, right, in groups again, once we get to that point, then we can do that. We'll make something out of it.
I don't know about your channel, but YouTube will probably cancel me and I'll lose all my subscribers if I do it because of my performance. But I'm still in. I'm still in.
It will go down in infamy. We can say that for sure. All right, guys.
All right, Trev.
Thanks, everybody, for watching. And if you're listening to the podcast version of this, listening, make sure you do give us that 5-star review over on Apple Podcasts. And if you're watching us on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Make sure you do follow Alan at Alan Sliwa on Twitter, also on Instagram. Right, Alan? You are at Alan Sliwa on Instagram, yep, as well, right? Okay.
Yep, on Instagram.
I should have known that ahead of time, but yeah. So follow him in both those places on social media. You can find me at Trevor_Lane on Twitter, at TrevorLaneNBA on Instagram, because I was not smart enough to do the same handle on both accounts. So you can follow me there. Till next time, everybody, stay safe and see you.